All right, today as part of the Tampa Explained series, we are going to talk about South Pinellas County, St. Petersburg area, and a few of the towns surrounding St. Petersburg. Here we go. For coming by the Living in Tampa channel, where every single week we make videos about what it's like to live and move to the Tampa, Florida area. If that's something you want to follow along with, don't forget to subscribe. I'm also a licensed realtor in the state of Florida, so if you have any real estate specific questions, my phone number and email are right there on the screen and in the description down below. So in this Tampa Explained series, we've been just seeking to explain the area piece by piece, and now we're over here in Pinellas County, which is the Gulf beaches, the beaches that are the Tampa beaches. But this whole area is a pretty big area over here. This county, Pinellas County, is 1 million people, and it's the most densely populated county in the state. And that density is not that high. Really what that means when it comes to density is that one town completely mixes into the next. There's really no space in between them. And I grew up in a small town in Oklahoma of 10,000 people, and then there was, you know, 10 miles of padding around every single town. This area is a far stretch from that. One town just kind of rolls into the next. You don't realize when the next one starts. So we are going to hit the main criteria of the Tampa Explained series, which is proximity, style, size, and cost. And the main towns in this area, St. Petersburg makes up a big part of the south side of this county. And we're talking about the south side of the county today. Next week will be central, the central area, which is kind of anchored by Clearwater. And then next will be the north side of this county, which is like Dunedin, Palm Harbor, Tarpon Springs. St. Petersburg makes up the bulk of this southern half of the county, and St. Petersburg has a population of a little over 250,000. But there are a few other towns mixed in here, like Gulfport, Seminole, and Pinellas Park. They feel very, very similar to St. Petersburg, so you may not even care to distinguish between those four cities, but they do occasionally have different addresses, so it's worth talking about. Of those other cities, Pinellas Park has about 50,000 people, Gulfport has about 12,000, and Seminole has about 18,000. But then you also have these little beach towns over along the beach, and these are separate towns. So St. Pete Beach, not St. Petersburg Beach, they changed their name to St. Pete Beach years ago. St. Pete Beach has about 10,000 people, Treasure Island about 7,000, Madeira Beach about 4,000, and then Reddington Beach and Reddington Shores has another 1,000. A lot of the population in these beach towns is condos and that style of housing, but there are houses around that area as well. Okay, so the boundary of this area on the east side, where the bulk of St. Petersburg is the Tampa Bay. This side faces the bay, faces South Tampa and that area. And then you go along south as this turns into the Gulf, and Seminole and Gulfport are here on the west side of this area. And then to the west of them are these little beach towns. And then on the north side of this area, I'm kind of cutting it off just south of Largo, so we can continue into that area with the next video. All right, number one in the criteria is proximity. This whole area is close to a lot of things, and it's very self-sufficient in its own. You don't need to go to downtown Tampa for a lot of things that you couldn't get in this St. Petersburg area. Even if it's a mall or Trader Joe's or Whole Foods, you have all those things very accessible right here. But if you do need to get to downtown Tampa, there are a few ways to commute. There's a toll road across the bay, and then there is Interstate 275 that goes across there and ends up just north of downtown. And then you can easily get downtown from there. And it would be a similar commute to the airport. And these are not long commutes. Of course, traffic is going to get a little bit backed up on these bridges if there is construction or during main commute times, like, you know, 8 to 9 in the morning and then 4 to 6 in the evening. But in general, since there are a few ways to go, it helps the flow of traffic quite a bit. If you want to get to the beach, there are a lot of beaches really close to here. You know, the most common being St. Pete Beach and like Indian Rocks, but then Fort DeSoto Park down south is another beautiful, beautiful beach. that has all kinds of little islands that you can take a ferry to as well, like Shell Key. But when it comes to shopping and daily needs, all that stuff is just around the corner from you. This area is a little older, so there's a lot of mixture of residential and commercial, which does provide for a kind of different feel to your residential areas, but it makes all kinds of things very accessible. All right, number two is style. There are a lot of older houses in this area, a lot of turn of the century, early 1900s stuff. But then during the 1950s to the 1970s, there was a lot of building in this area. And during that time, they built a lot of short houses to withstand the storms quite a bit easier. You have a lot of flat roofs or nearly flat roofs. And in general, the style of these areas is kind of eclectic. There are not many HOA style neighborhoods. Of course, there are some, being in an area this big, but they are kind of few and far between. There are a lot of really interesting areas like the Old Northeast in St. Pete or Kenwood in a more central St. Petersburg area. But you really have to drive a lot of these neighborhoods to know which one suits you best. As you go west into Seminole, this area is a little bit higher, kind of out of flood zones, which we'll touch on flood zones at the end. This Seminole area is a little bit higher and you have quite a bit more big houses in this area, 4 to 5 bedroom houses, but they're still pretty eclectic. There's some really cool houses in this area. As you go further west from Seminole into the beach towns, they are a little bit more like beach towns. They feel kind of quiet. There's not a lot of traffic going through them. They have all kinds of little shops and condos and hotels and all kinds of things like that right by the beach. And they're really fun places to visit or to have a second home. It's very common in those areas. Also, retiring into those areas is very, very common. And that's probably the bulk of the population in those areas. Okay, the third criteria here is size. Even though this area isn't a massive amount of population, St. Petersburg is one of the bigger cities in Florida, but the density of this area makes it kind of unique because it is really surrounded by water. And even though it's dense and somewhat city-like compared to other areas, there are still not that many areas where you feel like you can walk to restaurants and grocery stores. There are quite a few areas where you feel like you could ride a bike to those, but there's a big chunk of the year in the middle of the summer where you're not going to be wanting to ride a bike in Florida. All right, the fourth criteria is cost. And you have all ranges of costs in this area, from really low cost rentals that may not feel super safe, up to really beautifully restored turn of the century homes on Snell Island. You have all this kind of diversity, but there is kind of a mid-range, really that 250 to 450 range is kind of the typical range for a single family home in this area. I just had a closing last week that was a 3-bedroom, 1-bath house in St. Petersburg that closed for $312,000. But I have other clients that are searching in the 400s for an area like Kenwood. And these houses aren't that big. They're smaller. There's a lot of 2- and 3-bedroom houses. If you do want something bigger, if you want kind of a HOA style neighborhood, you've got to go further north from here. There are also a lot of condos in this area with all kinds of ranging costs, really from the mid 100s up into the 500s. One thing with condos to be really cautious of is the fees. These condo associations are very expensive at times. I've seen them as much as $500-$600 a month. And some of those, they offer a lot of things. They might even include some utilities with those costs. But if you don't need all of that stuff and you want to have a little more control of your expenses, you might want to look elsewhere. Okay, I said I would talk about flood zones and flooding. This area has a lot of houses built in flood zones. What that typically means. So this house that I closed on recently with my client in St. Petersburg was in a flood zone. And it's a flood zone AE, which is the lower one, like lower in terms of elevation. And they had to pay about $1,800 a year for their flood insurance. It's kind of a headache to go through when you're closing on the deal because your lender makes a big deal about it. The title company's trying to figure it out. Your insurance company's trying to figure it out. And everybody thinks about those kind of things differently. This mortgage was being issued by Chase, and they had some issues with it because they wanted the flood insurance to cover the mortgage value and not just replacement value of the home. So it does get kind of tricky at times. But in general, people are still buying houses and living in these flood zones. It's not like people are evacuating this area. A lot of these older areas, these older neighborhoods with houses in flood zones are still very, very popular. And typically this is just me doing research and talking to locals. When hurricanes come into this Gulf area, they pass over Cuba and then they slow down and they continue going straight and go into Alabama and like the Florida panhandle area. It's very rare that they make the turn back into the Tampa area. If they did, St. Petersburg is very exposed. But a lot of the threat in the midst of that is losing power and drinkable water. Where I grew up in Oklahoma is Tornado Alley. We would take cover in our schools when I was a kid. There were all kinds of storms like that where we had to take cover. And after you live there for a while, you just don't think about it that much. You know, that you might know that a storm is coming. You might know, oh, it seems like it's coming along here, but you mostly just watch the news to see if it's going to hit you. And then you kind of go about your day, maybe prepare a little bit in terms of having some water available if you did lose power or water. And it's pretty similar down here. People don't really panic. People, you know, are buying supplies when it leads up to that, but stores stock extra supplies just for the storm. And it's just something that we deal with as a community. Okay, so that is the South Pinellas County area, really anchored by St. Petersburg. I hope you found this information useful. And if you have any real estate specific questions, don't hesitate to reach out. My phone number and email are right there on the screen and in the description down below. We'll see you next time talking about Central Pinellas County.